Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com. This is Triangulation, episode 293, recorded Monday, April 10th, 2017. Ron Gilbert and Thimbleweed Park. Triangulation is brought to you by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you could post to 200-plus job boards, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. Try ZipRecruiter free at ZipRecruiter.com/twit. And by Square. Accept every card for the same rate and deposit your money fast with free chargeback protection. No commitment, no hidden fees. Sign up now to get free processing on your first $500 in sales at square.com/triangulation. Some terms apply. And by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. When it comes to the big decision of choosing a mortgage lender, work with one that has your best interest in mind. Use Rocket Mortgage for a transparent, trustworthy home loan process that's completely online at quickenloans.com/triangulation. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we get together with some of the most interesting people in technology, and we talk about technology, and we have a lot of fun, and sometimes we have a lot of games. And that kind of fun. Ron Gilbert is joining us. He is the creator of a new game called Thimbleweed Park. But you're going to recognize the name Ron Gilbert. And if you don't recognize the name Ron, you're definitely going to recognize Humongous Entertainment, the LucasArts Adventures game, Double Fine Productions. Hello. Welcome to Triangulation, Ron. It's great to have you.
Yeah, great to be here.
What was the first video game you, not designed, but played? Do you remember?
The first video game I played, it had to be like, you know, an arcade game. It was probably like Asteroids or something like that.
A lot of us started with Asteroids, or even I'm old enough to have started with Pong. In fact, I was in college when Pong came out. I remember going to a bar and wasting a lot of time and many quarters and drinking more than a few White Russians. Playing Pong.
That's hard to play Pong when you're drunk.
So I learned. But we didn't know at the time. We thought it might help. But that was a revelation, you know. And I guess people who were in computer labs had played Space Wars and other games and vector graphic games before that. But, boy, the first time you play a video game kind of imprints you.
Yeah, it certainly did me. I mean, I was really enthralled with them. And it was soon after that that I learned to program.
Was that the impetus? Did you want to write a game?
Yeah, I did. And, you know, I think when you're a kid and you learn to program, you know, video games is about the most interesting thing to do.
Yeah.
You know, writing accounting software just isn't the kind of stuff you want to do. So you want to write video games. And that's what I did, was I wrote a lot of video games taught myself to program.
That's neat. Did you write them in BASIC? Did you type in programs from Compute? What platform were you using?
I started in BASIC. That was the first language I used. The first program I ever did was actually on a programmable calculator that my dad had brought home from work. But computer-wise, it was BASIC on a Commodore PET, which is really how I learned to do stuff. And then after that, my family got a computer, and I very quickly jumped into doing assembly language just because it was a lot faster.
Wow.
I was, you know, doing Z80 assembly language for the kind of beginning of my foray into programming.
I think sometimes when people hear assembly language, they have the reaction, I did, wow, you must be, that's hardcore. But actually, compared to BASIC, assembly language might be easy, in some ways easier, because you're at least working directly with the machine, right?
It's probably a little bit harder because you're dealing with such, you know, minute little things. You know, at least in BASIC, you can do kind of larger calculations. But, you know, in assembly language, you know, you're dealing with numbers between 0 and 255. And, you know, if you want to deal with numbers larger than that, you need to, you know, do all of the calculations yourself for that stuff. So I think, you know, in that respect, it's harder. It's also harder because when your program crashes into assembly language, it really crashes, right? I mean, the whole machine just dies. So debugging is a lot harder.
Interesting.
In assembly language. Yeah.
You're. I'm seeing on the Wikipedia article that you had a North Star Horizon.
Yes.
I did a lot of early basic programming with a North Star Advantage. The North Star computers had some nice a nice BASIC and the vector capabilities, and you could do some really nice stuff.
Yeah, that was my first computer, and neat. It didn't have any graphics at all. So we bought a graphics card, and it came as a kit, and we built it, and put it in, my dad and I, and installed it into the computer. And I think it had a resolution of like 128 by 128 pixels. So it wasn't exactly super high res, but it could do a lot of colors, and that was fun.
Your dad must have been a geek.
Yeah, he was a physicist.
Oh, neat.
So, he had access to a lot of computers at college and stuff like that.
And used them at work, I guess, right?
Yeah, he used them. I mean, he was the person who really taught me to program.
Nice.
When he brought home that programmable calculator, and I didn't really know how to use it, but he'd use the programmable calculator, so he taught me that stuff.
But there was a game on that TI, wasn't there?
There were these little magnetic strips, right. That you'd run through it that had the programs on it. And he brought home some of them. And there was like a tic-tac-toe game.
Yeah,
I remember there was
like
a tic-tac-toe game, and there was like a weird little Hunt the Wumpus game,
Where
it's kind of like Battleship in right. some ways.
And you got a maze and yeah.
So the first game I did on that calculator was actually a Star Wars game where you try to shoot down TIE fighters. It was essentially Battleship, with TIE fighters and destroyers. That was the first game that I did.
This was back in the late 70s. Star Wars was the thing, right?
Yeah, probably 77, 78. Yeah,
that's when it came out, right? The Horizon came out, and I'm looking at the timeline because our Advantage was a little later. Your Horizon was an S100 bus.
Yeah, CPM machine.
CPM from 77, and the Advantage came out in 82, also Z80 based.
I think I had a Commodore 64 in 82.
Right. So did you go to school to become a computer science guy, a programmer?
I went to school. I mean, I learned to program when I was in junior high school, and I went to college, and I was majoring in computer science. But I was I was way more advanced than that a lot of the computer science courses were. And I remember I took I was in some programming class, and we had to figure out what our class end project was going to be. And I told the instructor I wanted to write an assembler. And, he was kind of shocked at that. He wanted me to write a sorting algorithm or something. And I wanted to write an entire assembler.
A language.
So, yeah.
Wow.
So, that's kind of what I did for my project there.
Oops, sorry. I started Maniac Mansion. I shouldn't have done that. now I'll be gone for a few hours. So it must have been exciting being a Star Wars fan coming out of college to go work for LucasArts.
Yeah, when LucasArts called, because they called me, I didn't apply for the job. They had called me because they were looking for a Commodore 64 programmer, and I had been recommended by somebody. And when they called looking for a programmer, I had no idea that Lucasfilm made games at all. I didn't know that they had a games group or any of that
stuff.
You weren't
alone.
So I was really, really surprised.
Yeah.
It was a great, right? I mean, it's like the dream job in some ways.
What was your first game? You were doing ports for the Atari 800, which means I was an Atari 800 fanatic, so that means I played a few of your games. What games did you port?
I ported Cronus Rift. Oh, that was the first game that I did.
Fun.
And then I also ported Ball Blazer from the Atari to
Ball
the
Blazer was great.
Yeah.
So you went the other way around, the other direction. Or no, you went from the Commodore to the 800?
No, I went from the Atari to the Commodore. I was porting from the Atari to the Commodore.
Oh, interesting. You were right. Of course, that's why they wanted a Commodore kid.
Yeah.
I get it. You're taking
Yeah, because they had nobody on staff that did
Right.
Commodore 64 programming.
There was a big difference, as I remember. The Atari had a lot of hardware support for sprites and for music and stuff. Was it hard to do those ports?
It wasn't particularly hard. I mean, they were both 6502 machines, right, which was a huge advantage because most of the code worked. But the graphics were quite different. I don't know that one had better graphics than the other, but they were just quite different. You right. know, the Atari had these, you know, very, I think they were very tall sprites that you could do, where the Commodore, you know, had basically square sprites and
things like so that.
It was a little bit different. And the Commodore, you know, did character set graphics really well, and the Atari
right.
you know, didn't. And, but I shared an office, with the guy who was doing the Atari port. And so we worked very, very closely perfect. Together to do that.
Yeah. Did you write tools to do it, or did you do it all by hand?
We had an assembler, Chip Morningstar, who worked at Lucasfilm. He had written a custom assembler for 6502, and so we had that assembler. And then I think they'd written a graphics program that did the graphics and the art and stuff for it.
Cool. Well, so what was your first original game that you worked on?
That was Maniac Mansion.
All right. You said the words. Now I have to play.
I started up.
This is actually a YouTube full playthrough. We could turn off the guy's. I'll turn off the guy's narration. But this was state of the art graphics adventure back in the day, and this was a horror title.
Well, it was a spoof of a horror title.
Okay, a spoof.
Yeah, and this is also the Nintendo version. This isn't the original Commodore version.
Yeah, let me see if I can find that. Yeah. But this was, early 80s?
It came out in 1987.
Late 80s, okay. Mm-hmm. So, because we were talking before the show, and I had really gotten engrossed in text adventures, you know, Crowther and Wood's original adventure in Colossal Cave, and then Zork came along in the Infocom games. And I played a lot of those, of course. And I mentioned, I thought it'd be really cool to play those again. And they're not that. It's too much. It's a lot of work. Or maybe
I never really got into the text adventures. No, yeah. I played the original adventure in Colossal Cave and stuff on the college mainframe computer, and I dabbled a little bit in Zork, but. Yeah, I think one of the big impetuses for doing Maniac Mansion was the graphics, that I enjoyed adventure games. I enjoyed, you know, that type of game, but I really wanted graphics and wanted to just be clicking on stuff on the screen and not typing.
So a graphics adventure does a very similar thing, but you have a picture, in the early days, rudimentary picture instead of a word picture. And then you have commands on the screen. So as you say, you can click. You see the commands here.
Yeah, you just have all the words right there on the screen you click on rather than typing them in. I mean, there's some advantages, also some disadvantages. I mean, I think a lot of, you know, text adventure purists really didn't like the graphic adventures because they didn't feel that they had the same, you know, freedom to be entering information and typing stuff. But, you know, I think what I found when I was, you know, researching Maniac Mansion was that, you know, although you could type in, you know, hundreds of different words to text adventures, it really only understood like 10 or 15 words, right? Everything else was just synonyms. And so that's when I kind of boiled it down to the verbs that you see on the Maniac Mansion screen.
You know what you lose? You lose the thrill and frustration of typing examine box, open box, pickup box, throw box, trying every possible verb with the box. And actually, that's the main reason I don't play text adventures anymore. I realize it's a lot of work. It's annoying. So now I might be It's a lot of typing. I might be a little more open to the idea of a graphical adventure. Did Maniac Mansion do... Was Sierra Online around by then doing graphical adventures as well?
Yeah, Sierra Online was around. Yeah, so they were still typing, right?
Oh, they were?
Yeah, you get the picture, but you still had to type in the words, you know, and you'd have to, I think you could move around the screen with the arrow keys, but if you wanted to pick up something, you still typed pick up. So they were this hybrid between, you know, text adventures and kind of true point and click adventures.
Right. Was Maniac Mansion the first one where you'd click on the commands?
I think it probably was. Wow. I mean, there were some games where you did kind of click on stuff, but I think Maniac Mansion was kind of the first true point-and-click adventure game, yeah.
A success right out of the box?
It kind of did okay. I don't think any of the stuff we did at Lucasfilm did super well. You know, Sierra was also was always the leader, you know, in that market. When we translated our games and we brought them over to Europe, we did extremely well. We did much better in Europe than we did in the United States. But Maniac Mansion wasn't a huge hit, you know, when it first came out. It was a game that took a while.
Interesting. We're going to play, if you're at all nostalgic about this era of point-and-click adventure games, Ron's got a new one, and I've got it here. It runs on Windows, Mac, and Linux. I'm going to run it on Ubuntu. Wow. They have it over at Good Old
Games.
It's
the future.
The future's here, Ron.
The future.
We never imagined we'd be able to play this on Linux. Let's take a break, and when I come back, I want to ask about Scum and the secret of Monkey Island. Ron Gilbert is our guest. This episode of Triangulation brought to you by ZipRecruiter. If you're hiring, if you're in the enviable, unenviable position of staffing your company, whether you're a sole proprietor and you want to be a sole proprietor plus one, or you're the HR person, it's both a challenge and an opportunity, because the person you hire could really make or break your company. A company's made of people, right? So the best people mean a great company. The worst people can mean you got to do the worst thing in business ever, which is fire somebody. And you don't want to do that, right? So let's do it right. Let's hire fast, easy, and most importantly, let's hire the right person. And that's what ZipRecruiter does. Assume the right person's out there. They're a needle in a haystack, though. How do you get to them? How do you know what job board that particular person's looking at today? Well, you don't need to. With ZipRecruiter, you post once on ZipRecruiter.com. And it posts to 200-plus job boards, plus Twitter, plus Facebook. So it's seen by the largest possible pool of applicants. They also have millions of resumes, current resumes on file, so they can match you up quickly. And the beauty of this is applicants don't call you. They don't email you. They all go into the ZipRecruiter interface. The ZipRecruiter interface formats their resumes so they're uniform, so it's easy for you to go through them. They can screen out people automatically. You can design questions, A, B, yes, no, multiple choice, even essay questions, that'll help you just eliminate people you don't want and narrow it down, and then rank them and hire the right one fast, sometimes in just a day or two. No more juggling emails. No more calls to your office. Get the job done, and get it done right, which I love. ZipRecruiter's been used by the big guys, the Fortune 100. It's been used by the little guys, the medium guys. We use ZipRecruiter. It is a great way to hire. Look at some of the people who've used ZipRecruiter, some of the big and small, AT&T and Burger King and Marriott and Volkswagen and Target and Dell, PayPal. Right now, you can post jobs on ZipRecruiter absolutely free when you go to ZipRecruiter.com/twit. You get a free trial, ZipRecruiter.com/twit. We thank ZipRecruiter not only for supporting our show, but for helping us do the job of hiring, which is no fun and yet really important. Are you getting ready for PAX? Do you go to PAX every year, Ron?
I sometimes. I mean, we didn't go to the Boston PAX. Well, actually, that's not true. We were showing the game in the Microsoft booth at Boston PAX, and I don't know if we're going to go to the Seattle PAX.
Okay. Just want to give people a heads up if you were. So Scum, I remember Scum very well. S-C-U-M-M, the script creation utility for Maniac Mansion. This is why I asked you about tools earlier on, because it doesn't take too long as you're writing software, if you're a good programmer, to start thinking, how could I make this easier? Is Scum designed to make it easier?
Yeah, that was the goal. You know, when I started working on Maniac Mansion, I just started programming the whole thing in 6502 assembly language.
Oh,
and
my God.
You know, it wasn't like a month into the project when I realized that was just a disaster waiting to happen.
Yeah.
And Chip Morningstar, and I mentioned him earlier because he had written the assembler that we used as well. You know, I started talking to him, and you know, he had suggested just writing a little scripting language, and so that's when I kind of went off and you know figured out, well, what should that scripting language be? And the goal was to create a language that was, you know, more like writing a movie script than it was actual programming. You know, the commands were these very high level commands. You could just get people to walk somewhere and you get them to play animations and get them to say things without having to deal with all of the, you know, the mundaneness of actually programming all of that. And so that was the Scum system.
So you could write in a higher level. Is Scum almost English like?
That's what the goal was, right? Yeah. The goal was to make it very English like. I don't think I completely achieved that because, you know, you are having to also code up a bunch of logic that happens, right? Sure. It's not just scenes about people walking around. So I think if you look at you know, Scum script, I think it's kind of this weird hybrid between, you know, a programming language and, you know, more natural language. Yeah.
I guess in The Secret of Monkey Island, there was a location called the Scum Bar.
Yes.
And that's how people learned that scum existed, which is pretty awesome. So then you go. So did you only do those two for? You did Grim Fandango or no?
No, I didn't do Grim Fandango. Okay. I did Maniac Mansion. It was my first game.
Okay.
And then I helped David Fox out with Zach McCracken. He did most of the game, but I was just doing support stuff with the Scum system. And then David and Noah Falstein and I did the Indiana Jones game.
Oh,
and
wow.
Then I did Monkey Island 1 and I did Monkey Island 2.
Nice. Classics. At this point, I mean, I know LucasArts for some reason struggled, but at this point, these must have been successes. They're thought of nowadays as classics, right?
Yeah, I think they're thought of as more successful than they actually were. You know, they did well, but they weren't huge hits. You know, like I said earlier, Sierra was always outselling us continually on this stuff, which was very frustrating to us. and I think, you know, certainly, like, you know, the cult-like status that Monkey Island has today, I mean, that's something that only came many, many years later.
Those gosh darn Williamses. Why I oughta.
And they're parsers where you have to type stuff in.
Fans were of their titles, right? Of their series. Like, people loved King's Quest, and that was really what kept them alive, right?
Yeah, I think King's Quest was their most popular one. Yeah. You know, and then they had, you know, Space Quest and Police Quest. And yeah. I mean, yeah. They were very good at attaching that quest name to everything, right? which kind of, you know, helped their overall brand quite a bit.
Right.
Where at Lucasfilm, you know, we were just doing a lot of original titles. Right. We didn't really, you know, do that as much. But, you know, King's Quest kind of had a head start. And I think it built this fan base into it that, you know, it took us a lot longer to build that fan base.
That's right. I think that's right. And, you know, people who are watching this now, especially younger people, probably don't understand what the landscape was like. You would actually have to go to a store, a software store, to buy these. And they'd be on the shelf, you know? And, gosh, I remember I used to go to a place in Berkeley that it was like crazy. The stuff was falling off the shelves and it was just jammed with software. And you'd have to look at the game while there were magazines, there wasn't that kind of robust system of reviews that there is today. So you'd have to say, yeah, maybe this will be good. And the problem is sometimes they weren't. So
yeah, it was all about that box, right?
It was the box. I mean,
that box was selling the game. That was the first the first opportunity we had to sell the game to somebody was that box. It was the screenshots on the box and the copy on the box, and that was like the most important marketing thing that we had back then.
There was no social media. There was no word of mouth. Geeks were far and few and far between, unless you lived in Berkeley or somewhere where there were, you know, meetings and things. You were kind of on your own. So I remember buying games and just being so disappointed. And I think that's why a title like King's Quest does well, because you at least know what you're going to get, right?
Yeah, I think that's really right. Actually, is because you didn't know. You know, a game would come out and you wouldn't read about it in magazines for 3 months, right? So you weren't getting a feel for what the game was, and people kind of knowing, oh well, I like King's Quest games, right? That was a safe purchase for people to make.
It was safe, exactly. What's weird also about LucasArts, they did the Indiana Jones, but they didn't do a lot of why didn't they do more franchise games?
Because they couldn't. Because before they had the Lucasfilm Games Group, they had basically sold the licenses to Star Wars to other companies.
Oh.
And so we couldn't make Star Wars games.
Oh, my God.
The Indiana Jones game was a weird anomaly because I believe the person that was supposed to do, the company was supposed to do the Indiana Jones game, actually didn't do what they were supposed to do. So we kind of had an opportunity to jump in on that license and do it. But we couldn't make Star Wars games at all. And I think that was a blessing in disguise, because I do believe that had we been able to make Star Wars games, that's all we would have made. You know, things like Maniac Mansion and Monkey Island, right, and Fandango and Loom, and you know, all these things just never would have existed had we been able to make Star Wars games.
And yet, okay, so at the time you probably were going, God, we want to make, we know Star Wars games would sell incredibly well. And yet when you look back now, a Star Wars game would have been a throwaway. And games like Loom are revered. You know, people,
yeah,
that they were so innovative and different. Somebody in the chat room, Keith512, saying, oh, Indiana Jones, the graphic adventure was my favorite game of all time. Those really influenced people in a way that yet another Star Wars game might not have.
Yeah, I think that's true. And I also think that, you know, if you look at Lucasfilm, or LucasArts as they're called now, is when they got the license to be able to do the Star Wars games, they really stopped doing all that original stuff, right, and they just became focused on the Star Wars games.
Right. You're just another cog in the Star Wars, you know, universe. You're not creating original. I mean, Loom was so original and amazing and interesting.
Yeah, Loom was great. Yeah, and that's why I think it was kind of a blessing, you know, that we couldn't make that stuff.
I think so. In hindsight, of course, it must drive you crazy at the time.
Yeah, at the time it did.
You go on to Humongous, and actually, I didn't play a lot of... I loved Grim Fandango. I played at Monkey Island, of course, who didn't? But it was because I had little children, Humongous looms large in my memory. We did Putt-Putt. We did Pajama Sam. We did Fat. We did all of those games. Did you work on all of those games? Was that your company or?
Yeah, that was my company.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah,
thank
yeah.
you.
And I worked on most of those games in some capacity. I mean, certainly the early games, I worked very, very closely on. Games like Spy Fox, I didn't work directly on. That was, you know, created by somebody else.
It's funny. That was more of a video game. And yeah, it's funny because I don't have the same feeling about that. But Abby, my daughter, who's now 25, I'm sorry, and I played Putt-Putt like crazy. We played Pajama Sam like crazy. It was a great lap. It was a great lap game, right?
Yeah, I really love those games. Yeah. You know, and I think our goal when we, you know, we did the games in Humongous was to build real adventure games for kids.
Right.
You know, we didn't want to build, you know, educational games. We didn't want to build, you know, watered down storybook games. We wanted to build real adventure games. You know, they had simpler puzzles, obviously, and you know, the characters talked, which they didn't really do in games at the time. I mean, that was a very innovative thing for the characters to talk and stuff like that. But you know, we wanted to build real adventure games for kids.
You know, it's funny. I should talk to Abby and see if she remembers Putt-Putt and Freddy Fish. We loved Freddy Fish. And let me play a little Freddy Fish just to give you an idea of this is the next kind of the next. You can see it's the next stage in the evolution. So now it's animated.
Thanks for getting the flowers.
They're talking. They're characters.
Thanks for getting, Freddy.
And, you know, because it was an adventure, it engaged me enough to play it with my daughter.
Bye, Freddy.
Whoa. The audio's not too good on this YouTube clip, but you get the idea.
Yeah, that was something we really wanted to do. And I think that's something that, you know, the Disney films and the Pixar films did really well, is they built, you know, these movies that were for kids, but adults didn't mind taking their kids to the movies because they were going to be as entertained as their kids were. You know, they weren't just cartoons. And that was one of the things we wanted to do with the Humongous Entertainment games, was to build something that you didn't dread sitting down, you know, with your daughter to play, but you actually enjoyed sitting down to play it.
Yeah, but it was easy enough that Ed, she was engaged and the characters were great. And actually, that's a real testament to you because the graphics at this time are not so sophisticated. You know, I don't know how many colors you have to work with, but it's not a very big palette. Is it? Are we
256 colors?
I mean, this looks rich and vibrant, and there's shadows, and it's three dimensional with 256 colors. That's kind of remarkable. Even the animation. So this is what, 95? Something like
that. Yeah, this is probably 94 or 95.
Okay. So we're talking PCs or.
It was PC and Mac.
I probably played it
on Mac. That was really the only two platforms that were worth developing for. And we tried to get on the console platforms. You know, we tried to get on the very first PlayStation, and they just didn't want the games at all. They did not want games for little kids because they were trying to project this more kind of grown-up adult nature for their consoles, and they just thought having kids games on it would bring the age down too much. So we couldn't get it into the consoles.
But Sony was really trying to distinguish itself from somebody like Nintendo, which was kind of had that kiddie. Or, you know, at the time you had Sega and you had Sonic and stuff like that. It was more kiddie. They were going after shooting people, killing people. You didn't kill enough people in Freddy Fish.
Yeah, it wasn't part of the demographic that they wanted to hit.
Well, I want to thank you for Humongous because even that logo and the opening animation is burnt into my brain in a very positive way. In fact, it's kind of, I hadn't thought about it in years and it was really fun. I thought,
those were probably the most fun that I've had making games.
That category has disappeared though. This was in the CD-ROM era and the educational game era. And
well, the reason it disappeared was that licensing just took over because the whole computer game, you know, market was so small back in the mid-90s that it wasn't worth doing that stuff. But then, you know, Disney started producing some games and then people just realized, oh, well, I can make a lot more money by buying a license. And so people stopped doing original content and they just started doing all this licensed stuff. And the whole market was just taken over by licensed products. Yeah.
They didn't learn anything from E.T., the E.T. game. They should have known. They should have seen it coming.
There's a desert full of E.T. cartridges out there.
Alamogordo. They're buried. I have a couple, actually. Somebody sent me the E.T. cartridges. I don't know what I would do with them. I guess it's just of interest. You also did the Backyard Sports series, which, like Backyard Baseball. And those are still around, right? I mean, I see those on iOS.
I think they are. I think they are still. I don't know if they're making new ones or not. Maybe they are.
So you don't. Yeah. So Humongous, did it get sold? What happened to Humongous?
It got sold, yeah. Okay. It was sold like in 96 or 95, something like that.
It probably got out just in time because I'm thinking of the collapse of Broderbund and...
It was like the very late 90s and the early 2000s when the kids market just completely died.
So sad. So sad. Good news, though, and I wonder how you feel about this. There are a lot of people who say, oh, Freddy Fish. Oh, I remember that. You can play many of these games on there's a Scum VM emulator. How do you feel about emulators?
I really like the Scum VM stuff. Yeah, you know, I think without Scum VM, a lot of these games just wouldn't be playable anymore, and that they really are. And I know if I go back and I play, want to play Monkey Island or any of those games, I do it all through Scum VM just because it's the easiest way to go do that stuff.
So you see, I mean, I guess if you're the company, if you're Nintendo, oh, you're stealing our ROMs. If you're Bandai, don't do that. But if you're the creator, this is keeping your art alive.
Yeah, it is in a lot of ways. And, Scum VM isn't, they don't give out Monkey Island or Maniac Mansion, right? I mean, they're not giving away the actual game, right? All they're doing is just emulating the engine of the game. Right. So, in theory, you still have to go buy the game or you have to have, gotten a copy, long before, but you can play it on modern hardware.
You know that these games are floating around. I mean, people aren't who use emulators.
No, people are honest. They buy everything.
Okay, good. Where did you, this was the era also of heavy duty DRM of copy protection. How did you come down on that? I guess you'd probably say, well, we have to, right?
I think copy protection is, I don't think there's anything you can do about it, right? I mean, it's, everything is always going to get broken, right? The most you can do is slow people down with copy protection. And, you know, I certainly feel that it's not worth my time. You know, it's not worth months of my work to slow down somebody 2 days, you know, to breaking the stuff, right? I just have better things to do. Exactly. And I think the thing about copy protection, and I think you see that with the advent of stores like Steam and GOG and all these places, is that if you give somebody a convenient way to buy something and you price it at a reasonable price, they will buy it. Most people will just buy it. And I think that's what places like Steam, you know, and even, you know, even the iTunes music store, right? I mean, they gave people a convenient way to buy music, and you see a lot of people will just buy the music. So I think that's kind of what you need to do with piracy, is give people a way to buy it.
I have to agree with you 100%. I just wanted to give you the opportunity to say otherwise, but that's exactly right. And it doesn't stop pirates.
No, it doesn't. I mean, the movie industry has gone to extreme, you know, levels to try to, you know, copy protect DVDs and Blu-rays and all this stuff, and it's all just completely broken.
Yeah.
There's just no way to solve it. But, you know, if I want to watch a movie, it's so much easier for me to go, you know, pay $3.99 and rent the movie on iTunes than it is for me to surf around the web and, right, you know, and it BitTorrent the thing down. So I'll just pay the $3 to do it. And I think that's true of a lot of people.
I do think that I, you know, whether you make any money on Scum VM or not, I won't say this, but I won't put words in your mouth, but I will say that, I mean, this is the art of this generation, and they should be preserved as much as a TV show or a film or a painting should be preserved, or music should be preserved. These were artistic creations.
Yeah, and that's really hard with computers, right? You know, because the technology changes. Right. You know, the technology of projecting a film hasn't, you know, changed since the, you know, early 1900s, right? So it's really easy to just keep moving those to a new medium, but computer games are very different. And so I think emulators are the way that we're going to be able to preserve that stuff.
Thank God, you know, thank God. And there's also this great nostalgia factor for people who grew up with putt-putt. They want to be able to play putt-putt, right, or at least, yeah, see it, or show their kids putt-putt.
Yeah, or get their kids. I mean, right, maybe you grew up, you know, as a kid playing putt-putt, right, but now you have kids, right, and you want your kids to experience
it. You could do that with a TV show. You know, I could say, hey, kids, come over. It's Andy Griffith I grew up on. And they can enjoy it. In fact, a lot of kids like older TV shows quite a bit. You know, it's a nostalgia thing. I think the same thing would happen with the video games. But you were smart. In 96, you got out of kids stuff, and you went back to designing for grown-ups, and as a result, I think I see on the computer gaming world ranked you as one of the 15 most influential people of all time in computer gaming. That's for the Scum Engine. GameSpot put you on their list in 1996. We are talking to number 15. Ron Gilbert.
You couldn't get numbers 1 through 14 to show up.
Best we could do.
You know.
Actually, no. We talked to Tim Schafer, I think, a little while ago. We're gonna talk more about the new, because there's still more history, and then I want to give you a little demo of the new game, because you're back to making, you know, the Scum style games that you made your mark in so many years ago, and I hope that there's a audience for those and for new adventures in those.
Yeah, I do too.
Yeah, yeah. It's kind of exciting. You don't mind going back to that medium?
No, not at all. Yeah. It's, I think doing kind of pure point and click adventures is a lot of fun to do that. And there certainly are a lot of people that really enjoyed them, and they're really not getting made anymore.
No.
So,
yeah.
I mean, a little bit of it is kind of an experiment. You know, people kind of, you know, wax nostalgic about those games. Well, what if there was a new one? You know, is it something that they would still enjoy in the same way? Or is it just all about the nostalgia for the stuff? And so that's, you know, really interesting to see.
Well, we'll pay a visit to Thimbleweed Park in just a moment. Ron Gilbert is our guest today on Triangulation. It's great to have him. And again, thank you for Humongous Games, man.
You're welcome. Huge, they were fun. They were a lot of fun.
Yeah. Our show today brought to you by Square. I'll never, you know, it's really fun. I love covering technology, and I, part of the reason I like it is there are those moments where you see and use a new technology and you go, this is it. This is big. This is huge. And I'll never forget getting that first Square card reader. It was free. I sent away for it. I don't sell anything. I just thought, this is an interesting idea. You plugged it into the headphone port on your phone, and then you could take credit cards. And it was beautiful. It was elegant. You got the on-screen receipt, and you'd email it. It was just like a new way of doing business. I was blown away by it. I said, these guys are going places, and they have. Square lets you take payments anywhere, any way your customers want to pay, so you never miss a sale. Maybe you saw the Square point of sale systems with the using the iPad. Makes it very easy with just something you've already got. You put your Square, your iPad in the Square stand, and you've got a complete point of sale system. And now you know because people now have chip cards. Square has, they still sell the, actually give away the free MagStripe reader that goes in the headphone jack. But they also now, you can accept chipped cards and NFC payments with a new Square reader. It's $49. It's compatible with iOS and Android. Uses Bluetooth LE, so you don't have to worry about Apple dumping the headphone jack. I knew Square would respond to this. I was curious what they were going to do. And this thing is actually great. And it solves the problem because now they can tap to pay as well as swipe. And the best thing about Square is they have a very rational pricing system. Sign up in minutes. You can accept every single major credit card. And the rate is flat. One simple rate for all cards. 2.75% per swipe, dip, or tap. Compare that to the other guys. That is a really great deal. 3.5% and 15 cents if you want to do a keyed-in transaction. But you got the swipe thing. You got the tap-to-pay thing. This is great. They'll create custom pricing packages if you're a bigger business. No problem. Never any hidden fees, penalties, or commitments. You just pay for what you use. And Square pays fast. They deposit your money within one or two business days. If you want them, on-demand deposits, just 1% of the total deposit amount as well. And I love this. Along with everything else you get from Square, you get $250 a month in free chargeback protection. Check your sales on the Square dashboard. There's a PC app and an iOS app. You can see historical and real-time sales data, track inventory, send marketing campaigns, create loyalty programs, and more. What a revelation it was. You know, for people like, you know, if you're a plumber or a handyman, you could actually go to the worksite and get your customers to pay right there. What a transformation. People could go around at conventions and sell shrink wrap, you know, software or merchandise. It's changed the world. It's changed the world. Great security, great customer support. It's all in there. It's Square. See how Square works for your business. If you sign up now, free processing on your first $500 in sales. But here's how you find that. Square.com/triangulation. So you got to go to that page, square.com/triangulation. Some terms apply. square.com/triangulation. Thank you, Jack, and the Square team for making something that changed the world. square.com/triangulation. Thanks for your support of our show. My guest, Ron Gilbert, is a game designer, a legend. He may be number 15 on the GameSpot list, but he's number one in our hearts. And has apparently excellent timing. You left LucasArts before they went downhill. They got acquired as part of the Disney deal, right? Yeah.
By Disney now.
Yeah. Which means, of course, they're going to be doing, you know, Pirates of the Caribbean games now, not.
Yeah, I don't know. They really got out of the whole games business.
That's
like
true.
About a year ago, I think. They That's just true. Said, we don't want in this business.
That's sad.
I mean, they bought Lucasfilm for Star Wars.
Right. They got the franchise. They got what they wanted. But you've been smart. You've kind of like hopped from lily pad to lily pad. So you left LucasArts. You created humongous games, made brilliant children's games. But then as that market started to collapse, I guess you had been doing a side project all along of more adult games when you were doing Humongous.
Yeah, the last couple of years of Humongous, I was working on a game called Good and Evil. But that game never came out. But I started doing more adult stuff, and then when I left Humongous Entertainment, I started doing casual games just because that was a market that really interested me. A friend and I, who I'd worked with in Humongous, he and I did a bunch of casual games for a while.
That was before the iPhone, though. What were you?
Yeah, it was like with real networks. You know, it had real games, and there was some other company that was really big. Big Fish, you know, had it was stuff. They were all kind of casual PC games.
But they were
just a lot of fun. No, they were all, you know, for Shockwave. The computer. They were all written in C.
Okay. Tell me a little bit about your game design philosophy. How do you do it on pencil and paper first? How do you think about a game before you start coding?
I do a little bit on pencil and paper. You know, I'll draw, like for an adventure game, right? I'm just drawing lots of charts, you know, about how the puzzles connect together.
Is it like a decision tree? Is it like a storyboard?
Yeah, it's a little bit like that. I call them puzzle dependency charts. And if you go to the, you know, blog.thimbleweedpark.com, I actually put a bunch of puzzle dependency charts for Thimbleweed Park up there.
Oh, neat.
So people can see how they are. They look like graphs, right? They look like kind of a, you know, a flow chart, but they're not really a flow chart because they're not about the flow of the game, you know, from kind of, you know, the beginning to the end. They're more about how the puzzles are dependent on each other. These are all the whiteboards that we did when we were designing Thimbleweed Park. So you kind of see a little bit of our thought process.
Well, this is really open of you. I can't believe
we would just sit down and walk up everything on the whiteboards.
Wow. And don't read these. There's spoilers.
Yeah,
there's
huge spoilers.
But I love it that you're documenting like this. I mean,
yeah, from the beginning, that's really what we promised in the Kickstarter, is we were gonna, you know, have this blog and we were gonna talk about it, you know, every aspect of the project. So, in the 2 years that it took us to build Thimbleweed Park, you know, we did hundreds of these blog entries where, you know, at least twice a week we talked about what we're working on and kind of, you know, we wanted to do it spoiler free. So we didn't really come out and talk about stuff. We had to dance around a lot of issues, but we tried to be open.
But is fantastic for anybody who's got an interest in the kind of how things...
This thing you're looking at right now, this is one of our first tests of our engine, because we wrote our engine from scratch. And so this is one of the first tests that we did for the engine.
Is this the first game you've crowdsourced?
Yeah, it is.
How is that? I mean, I love it that it encouraged you, maybe even forced you, to kind of show the sausage being made from the beginning.
It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun to do. And I think with crowdsourcing, I mean, it's kind of a double-edged sword, right? Because you can, you know, you can get money from the fans, but, you know, you really have to keep the fans very involved in what's going on, very up to date, right? It's not so much that that you're taking direction from them, but you do really need to kind of tell them what you're doing. Because a lot of Kickstarters run into problems because they get the money and then they just vanish. And it's not that they're not doing work, but nobody sees anything. Right. And then, you know, 9 months later, people are screaming because they don't know what's going on. And so the tack that we really took with the Kickstarter was just, you know, to always tell people, this is where we are and this is what we're doing.
I think this is so great. You even had a podcast and did dozens. You did 66 episodes.
Yeah, we did a lot of those. Yeah, we did podcasts. Those were a lot of fun to do.
I think that's just so cool. And I would guess it's kind of satisfying for you to have, it's a very different way of doing a game. You're developing it with the community. I don't know how much input were you getting from the community?
We got input on some things, right? You can't take input on like core design decisions, right? Because a lot of times that would be spoilers for the community.
Right.
And also design decisions are incredibly complex, right? You have this very complex machine that you're working on, and you can't just change one thing without it affecting everything else. So, you know, it's hard for, you know, people to just come in from the outside and go, oh, I think you should do this, right? Because it's like, well, if we do this, it's going to affect all these other things. But the areas that we really, you know, try to keep people involved is, you know, there's a gigantic library in the game, and, you know, we ask people to submit books for the library. So we have around 1,000 books in the library that people can go, you know, read, two pages of every book, and all those were submitted by readers of the blog and backers. And we have the phone book where, you know, the names of backers are in the phone book, and they could even record a voicemail message. Oh. So if you call up that phone number, you get to hear a voicemail message that one of the backers recorded.
Oh, that's awesome. What a great idea.
Yeah, that was fun. That was our $50 reward tier for our Kickstarter.
How much did you end up raising?
$626,000.
Is that enough to cover the cost of developing something like this?
Not fully. We did raise some additional money through some angel investors. I think in total we've spent probably around $1 million making the game.
$1 million. Wow. I mean, that's kind of, I mean, especially compared with, I don't know, how much do you think it costs to make Maniac Mansion? I mean.
Well, yeah, Maniac Mansion was a lot less. Yeah. I mean, that was really only three people worked on that game. You know, it was me and Gary and David Fox came on at some point. So that was like three people. That's a three-person team where, you know, Thimbleweed Park was probably around 12 people in total, and also a lot more art, you know, than Maniac Mansion or even a game like Monkey Island had. There was so much more animation and art in Thimbleweed Park. So it just, you know, became a little more expensive to do.
Artists more expensive than coders?
It kind of depends on the level.
Right.
You know, it's like, I would say they're pretty much even, right. Yeah, you know, at some level. You know, if you get really experienced artists, they're going to be a lot more expensive than your, you know, rank and file programmer and vice versa. I think we probably spent more money on programming than art in the game.
Okay. You had a community that is global too. I see you had a Euro tour for Thimbleweed Park.
Yeah, we went to Europe.
That's fun. And it's funny because you think of these as kind of classically American games, but I guess not really.
No, point-and-click adventures are actually, at least the Lucasfilm style ones, were far more popular in Europe than they were in the West. And if you look at the sales of Thimbleweed Park, that's totally borne out. I mean, we sold more copies in Europe than we have in the U.S.
How interesting. Of course, you've got every language, I'm sure. You just localize the strings and...
Yeah, we did French and Italian and German and Spanish localizations.
Interesting. I can't thank you enough for the blog, because it's rare that you get to see from the inside the process involved in this. And so if you're interested in Ron's work and you really, you know, you're curious, there's the Italian version. If you're curious what it takes to make a game. I mean, this is an amazing record. I don't think any game has been this completely documented from beginning to end. I think this is unprecedented.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff. Yeah. We really, you know, tried to take people through all the steps that it took to build the game.
Really, really cool.
And now that the game's out, you know, we're going to start releasing, you know, like you saw in the latest one, we're going to start releasing all of our design notes because we don't need to worry about spoilers anymore. Right. So we can show, okay, well, here are all the design documents we used to put it together.
Yeah, don't look until you play the game. But once you play the game, I mean, this is really cool. Don't look. Close your eyes. Close your eyes, everybody. Thimbleweed Park is available on Mac, Windows. I'm running on an Ubuntu machine. It runs wonderfully on Linux. Runs on Xbox too, right? It's available for Xbox.
Mm-hmm. And we'll have the mobile versions out in a couple of months.
See, that's interesting because I think that it's a lot of game developers are just saying I'm going to go straight to mobile. I guess this would be a great iPad game. There's no reason why not. Why did you do a PC version at all?
Well, I think the PC market is actually a kind of a stronger initial market for this type of games. I think, you know, mobile games tend to sell for less, and they're really dominated by the free to play stuff. And this isn't
That's
going
true.
To be a free to play game. This is going to be a this is going to be a premium game. And it just felt better to kind of go out on PC where we knew we were going to have a really strong audience for, and then do the mobile games as a second step.
If there is a bane in the gaming industry, it's second only to the licensing. It's freemium.
Free to play is really hard. The thing I don't like about free to play is it really it takes a lot of game design away, because you're not designing a game now. It's like now you're kind of building a game. To be honest, it's a game that's really trying to dig into that kind of gambling mentality that we have, right?
Yes.
It's really not about making a game that's fun. It's about making a game that's addictive.
It's pernicious.
And those are two very, very different things in my mind.
It's a very pernicious trend. And unfortunately, these game companies have gotten really good at manipulating us, you know? I mean, it's just terrible.
But the reason that they're so good at it is that they have this kind of live, real-time information about what you're doing.
They have the data.
And so they can just finely tune everything that they do to kind of maximize your addictiveness to the game. And they can do it live. You know, they may not know what you specifically are doing, but they certainly know what all their players are doing. And they can just make little changes, you know, live on their servers that just, you know, affect the game. And it's like, it's not game design in my mind, right? And so I enjoy game design.
No, it's Skinner box design. It's horrific. You know, they did this with World of Warcraft. So they would watch, you know, which dungeons had the most response, were the stickiest, got people to play longer. And instead of designing a game as a game, they're designing it, as you say, as a mechanism to get people to play more.
I played a lot of World of Warcraft.
I know, it's very addictive.
that's probably the game I've played the more hours of than any game in existence.
You had a guild, a Monkey Island guild, or?
Yeah, I had a Monkey Island guild.
Yeah.
And I created a character named Guybrush, and if you wanted to be a part of the guild, you had to create a character that was a character from Monkey Island.
Oh, nice. So you were Guybrush.
I was Guybrush.
A level 70 mage.
Who else would I be? I was a level 70 hunter.
Hunter. Ooh. And I bet, I mean, do you look back at the hours? I mean, and it has to be many, many, many hours. I know
thousands.
Yeah, thousands. And say, oh, I'm really glad I spent thousands of hours of my life in World of Warcraft.
Well, I actually was. And the reason is because, you know, because I was part of a guild, I was a part of two guilds. I had the Monkey Island guild, which was a very casual guild. And I was also a part of a hardcore raiding guild. And, you know, I spent thousands of hours, you know, raiding, but I met a lot of great friends. And to me, you know, the hours that I would spend every week, you know, raiding with my guild really weren't about the raiding. It was about being with these friends, right? Because we were all in voice chat and we were all talking back and forth. So I actually enjoyed the time because of the social aspect of it, you know, a lot more than the gaming aspect of it.
Let's take a break, and when we come back, let's play the game.
Okay.
You can help me through a little of the early stages.
I'll be your online hint guide.
Thimbleweed Park. Ron Gilbert is our guest, the 15th most influential man in gaming. I'm sorry.
Make sure you let everyone know I'm only the 15th.
I'm like the 800th, so it's okay. You know, it's okay. Our show today brought to you by Rocket Mortgage from Quicken Loans. I'm really more like the 800 millionth. Quicken Loans is, of course, the best mortgage lender in the country. The best. One of the biggest, too. And they're beloved. All you have to do is look at their website, quickenloans.com/triangulation. See all those customer satisfaction awards year after year. Number one for mortgage origination and mortgage servicing. Or just ask people in downtown Detroit, because it's so cool what Quicken Loans is doing to revitalize Detroit. It's a great company, and they love technology. So they have made something just for us, and I love it. I love the idea. It's a mortgage that you can get approved for completely online. Not only don't you have to go to a bank or a mortgage lender, you can submit all the paperwork online. Touch of a finger, because you can do it on your phone, on your iPad, you can do it on your computer. Quicken Loans has created Rocket Mortgage, and it's going to lift you through the home loan process. Whether you're buying a new house or you're refinancing your existing home, you won't have to waste time searching through stacks of paperwork. You can share your financial info securely including whatever it is, pay stubs and check statements. You can. It's online, so it's friction-free. You can adjust the rate and length of your loan in real time to make sure you get the mortgage solution that's right for you. I mean, you can skip the bank, skip the wait, and go completely online. This is for us. This is for the geeks. QuickenLoans.com/triangulation. Fortunately, when Ron Gilbert was writing games on the Commodore 64, somebody was writing banking software. And that's how he cut his teeth. And now he's doing Quicken Loans and Rocket Mortgage. We can't all be game designers. Quicken Loans and Rocket Mortgage, just for you. Equal housing lender, licensed in all 50 states, NMLSConsumerAccess.org, number 3030. Although I have to say, it's kind of game-like when you're doing the loan application. It's kind of fun. I would never say that before. It was nothing fun in the past. Rocket Mortgage is at quickenloans.com/triangulation. You probably don't need it right now. You're not buying a house right now. But if you are, and if you're not, make a note of it so that when the time comes you need a loan, you'll know where to go. Ron Gilbert is our guest. Fortunately, he did spend his youth writing an assembly, 6502 assembly language. You didn't write 6502 assembly. You did Z80 assembly.
I started in Z80, but the Commodore 64 was a 6502. So when I moved over to the Commodore, I did 6502.
It must have been very frustrating. That was a nightmare process.
Oh, I loved the 6502.
Really?
Oh, yeah. I loved it. I loved it because it was simple. You know, I look at, you know, the instruction set for, you know, modern processors today, and they're just so complicated. Yeah. And I liked that the C64 was just so simple.
It was really designed, I don't even know if it was designed to be a general purpose microprocessor. I feel like the 6502 was going to be a calculator chip or something.
Yeah, it's like one step above a calculator chip.
And
yeah.
Woz said, well, we got a bunch of these in the closet here at HP. Let's make a computer. I mean, it was, anyway, we've gone past those days. Although I have to say, maybe we, with x86, we could probably do better. Here is Thimbleweed Park on Linux. Thank you. This is the walkthrough tutorial. So, and this is my pointer, as you can see. And so you're going to give your characters things to do by clicking on the verb. Here's your inventory. See, it's really easy. It's not, you don't have to figure out how to do adventure games. And yet, if you're an old-time adventurer, I think you'll feel fairly comfortable with the idea because it's the same thing. So, we start back in 1987. Did you choose that? Why did you choose that era?
Because that's when Maniac Mansion was released.
So this is in a universe coexistent with the Maniac Mansion.
Yes. Universe.
Do any of the Maniac Mansion characters appear?
I can't. There might be some kind of weird homages to them, but not directly.
No,
of
you can't probably. But
right.
Look for the homages. And by the way, 8-bit graphics, right? I mean, this is more than 256 colors, but you're trying.
Yeah, it's all 8-bit pixel art. Yep.
I love it. Isn't it kind of gratifying that kids today actually like this stuff?
Yeah, there's this interesting resurgence, you know, of 8-bit art. You know, there've been some very successful games that have used 8-bit art. I mean, I just love it. I mean, even if I didn't have to use it, which I obviously don't, you know, I like it as an art form.
There's a game our 14-year-old plays that is graphically as primitive as you can get. I can't remember the name of it, and it's huge with all the teenagers, all the early teenagers. It's not Five Nights at Freddy's. It's I can't remember the name of it. He loves it so much he was one of the characters from the game for Halloween. Undertale, that's it. Undertale.
Oh, yeah,
have
that
you seen
one's,
that?
Yeah, I have, yeah.
It's black and white. 8-bit black and white. Oh, you got anti-aliasing in here? No. You know what? I'm having trouble with my audio, and I apologize, Ron. This isn't going to do it justice because it's not you, it's me. He's a little choppy. Is that a German accent? So you have
it
voice
is,
actors.
Yes.
You have voice actors. Yep. You have click on open and click on the gate. All right, let's see if I can manage this. And now
it's just that simple.
It's just that easy. By the way, I know that I have a note in my wall. I should look at the note. Always look at the note. Some tips here. Okay. All right. Apparently, my name is Boris. I see I have a B on my wallet.
and it has 252 American dollars in it.
Oh, thank you, boss.
Is the key card.
Did you have fun doing the voice work on this?
Yeah, there were 47 speaking parts in the game.
Wow. Did you get 47 actors?
Not 47. I think there's around 25 or 30 actors. And we spent around 6 weeks in the recording studio recording.
I am supposed to meet someone down here. Have you seen anyone?
Do you have any whiskey?
Do you have any whiskey? I love this. And of course, you got to have a little sense of humor.
Sober up, sir.
Listen.
I'm glad Chuck is dead. Ruined my life.
Ooh, we're getting some information here. Chuck is dead. Hmm. Well, I don't know. Should I spend more time with the bum?
Sleep well.
And I can walk by clicking on the ground. This is fun. And really, what I like about... I kind of understand why the 8-bit appeals. Because it's now more about story and humor and fun. And less about hyper-realistic graphics, right?
Yeah, I think with the 8-bit art, we've always thought about it as, you know, the art is more icons than it is anything else, right? I mean, that person on the screen is not so much a person as they are just an icon for a person.
Right.
And, you know, much like reading a novel, it kind of lets you fill in the details of things.
So I'm going to go to the rock, I'm going to pick up the rock, and I'm going to smash that light.
I wonder if I can use this rock to put out the light.
Yes, you can. I think. Push, pull, use. How about use? Use, and then rock.
Trestle Trail to Thimbleweed Park.
Oh, I screwed up. Well, you don't want to watch me play this game. You want to play this game. You can go to good old games, GOG.com, and play it Linux, Mac, PC. If you're going to get it on the Xbox, I presume you go to the Microsoft Xbox Store, yes?
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you just buy it right on your Xbox.
How different was that developing for the Xbox?
No, not too different. You know, the Xbox, certainly the current Xbox, is really just a Windows machine. So, you know, a lot of everything we had done for the Windows version, you know, was transferable to the Xbox. Yeah. The custom things are, you know, the achievements and, you know, dealing with you know, their store and all that took, you know, a fair amount of custom writing, but it really wasn't that much.
Use rock on light. Good, I smashed it. The light is out. Yay! Ron, it's been a thrill. Thank you so much, and again, thank you for years of entertainment. I don't know how many hours I've spent playing your games, but I am thrilled to have another one to play, and I'll be doing that tonight. Way too late.
Yeah, well, thanks for having me.
Thank you.
It's a lot of fun.
A lot of fun to talk to you. Everybody should get Thimbleweed Park and play it and look for, I don't know, maybe some homages, maybe some references, some surprises. There might be something in there for fun. GOG, goodoldgames.com, or on Steam. You're on Steam too. Oh, good.
Yep. And the App Store.
And the App Store for Mac. And I don't want you to make an announcement, but this would be a great iPad game.
Yeah, we will. We will probably in a couple of months. We'll have it out on iOS and Android.
Good. Android too. Thank you.
Yep.
Nice. So look great on my new Galaxy S8. Thank you, Ron. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Ron Gilbert. Ladies and gentlemen, we do Triangulation every Monday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern, 1800 UTC. If you want to tune in live and be part of the, you know, the third side of that triangle, we'd love it. You could join us in the chat room at irc.twit.tv. But of course, if you can't, we have on demand audio and video of all of our shows available at our website, twit.tv/TRI, or wherever you subscribe. And if you're listening on a plane, well, you could listen, you know, find more shows because there's lots more great stuff like this. If you are a fan, and maybe you saw the great show we did with Snowden's lawyer some months ago. Good news, we got nominated for a Webby Award for that, I'm very happy to say. And you can vote now through, I think, April 20th or 21st. So if you would do me the honor, if you liked the show and you want to vote for us, we're nominated in the technology category of the People's Voice Awards. We have a short URL for you, twit.to/webbies2017. And you do have to log in, but you can use your Twitter or Facebook account. They do that to kind of reduce overvoting. Not that we would ever encourage you to vote more than once at all. And I thank you for your support. Thank you for being here. We'll see you next time on Triangulation.